everybody, it's Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com. Today we're going to be talking about our seed catalog Bonanza. Yes, Rick got a hold of the seed catalogs before I even saw them. And he kind of went a little wild and crazy and bought quite a few interesting and very bright plants. You'll be seeing them. We're going to show you some of the things that he got carried away with, but we will all enjoy. But before we even start that, we wanted to make sure that when we started planting these, we kept a record of what they were, maybe a few characteristics about them, and where we got them, and just so we are organized and know what we are growing. About a year ago, Rick made some garden journals, and these were places where I could write down those very things. What plant do I have? What's a common name? Perhaps what's the Latin name? How tall does it get? When did I plant it? Where did I plant it? How much it cost? All those things. So he put together a journal for me, and it's been very handy. And then he even had a littler one that he did in total color, which is more expensive, obviously, but so much fun to write in. We just wanted to let you know that it's important that when you do have things that you're putting in your garden, maybe for the first time, and you want to remember what you put there, it's great to take pictures of them, write it down, walk around and make sure you're keeping track of them and how they're doing. And it's fun to look back on them then and say, oh yeah, that one really worked well. But something else that Rick tried this year too is to put down the actual picture of the plants that we are planting and what the commercial plant picture looks like itself. So it would be something that you would get on a seed packet or something that you would see as a tag that's inside the plant, so that right there you have a picture of what it's supposed to look like when it grows and tells you everything that you need to know about it. Long before spring was even in our wish list, that we knew it was not going to come for a long time, Rick found something that we have a large version of that he built for us in an indoor greenhouse. But we were also interested in something that was smaller that we could keep in the house, and then we wouldn't have to worry what temperature it was outside, even though it's on a back porch. This is when he found biodomes. They're little tiny greenhouses that you keep in the house. They come with bio sponges, they're called, that already have a hole in it, and they just fit right into this little styrofoam bed here. It has a tray on the bottom so that you water from the bottom. It wicks up through the little bio sponge and gives just the right amount of moisture for your plant. And it also has these little vents on the top so that if it gets too warm or too humid in there, you can open the vents up or even tip up the dome. But we thought that might be nice to try some plants in-house, but still in a greenhouse situation. This is the smallest one, then there's one that comes in between, and this is the large one. So those are called biodomes. And they should last year after year. These are replaceable, so once you use these up, you can replace them. I suppose you could put your own filler in there if you wanted. A mixture of potting seed, potting soil, but it comes ready prepared. Quite often, we'll plant flower seeds and flower seed vegetables rather than buying the plant. One of those was a Russian sunflower that my father gave to us long ago, and they grew to be 14 feet tall. We haven't been able to find seeds like that, and so our friend Tim from Upper Michigan went on a hunt and found monster sunflowers, mammoth gray-striped sunflower seeds that will give, that are monstrous and gigantic, up to 15 to 18 feet tall. That'll do it. So I will be starting some of these indoors before the first frost comes, the last frost comes, and I'll plant some of them outdoors so that we have a variety of probably seed times that they will sprout, obviously, and give us the best of both worlds. But we want to thank Tim very much for these monster sunflower seeds. We're looking forward to seeing them. But we've also been to different stores. You can't go into a big box store or even a grocery store now without finding seeds of flowers and vegetables. And then we go to Stein's perhaps and find all sorts of bulbs and just different plants, even dahlias. Big dahlia blossoms, a begonia, an orange begonia, my favorite elephant ears, and caladiums, which seem to be one of my new favorites. And then over here, what do we have? Oh, gladiola. Rick got those for his sister because she loves those. And liatris, one of my very all-time favorites. We never have actually bought liatris in this form. We've always, I think we started with one plant. And then we just grew our own from all of our seeds. And, of course, onions. But we also have seeds and plants that Rick has ordered. Oh, and another way of growing your plants, if you're going to start them indoors and you don't want to interrupt their growing and disturb their roots, is by using cow pots. Our friend Ann uses these all the time. She loves them. They're made with composted cow manure and biodegrade right into the soil and put nutrients back into the soil for your plants. These are like the old peat pots. We've been looking a long time too, because last fall Rick found these wonderful ones. This is a rare vanilla strawberry hydrangea plant. And this is a rare blue evening blooming primrose. So that'll be interesting to try. Then we have this mystery one. We have no idea what this is. Obviously, they're very tiny. So we'll have to keep them in a very small pot to start with till we figure out what they are. But in this book that Rick has put together is the variety of seeds and plants that some of them were still waiting to come because the season just isn't right yet to ship them. We're going to show you some of the flowers and plants that we're going to be putting in that Rick has included in our photographic journal this year. The first one we're going to put in is a Capriola cosmos. Now, you know, cosmos, they get very, very tall. Well, this one does not get so tall. This one stays short. It's a tricolor, which means it's got three colors on each flower. And the pollinators love it. It's also self-seeding. So even though it's not an annual, it will seed itself and you don't have to worry about it. Only gets 2 feet tall. The next one is the Superhero Spry Marigold. This is brilliant. These are brilliantly colored marigolds. They bloom earlier than the normal ones. You don't have to deadhead them. They get 10 inches tall. And marigolds are great to plant around tomatoes because they kill the nematodes that are bad for your tomatoes. So we love marigolds. The next one is the Hello Yellow Butterfly Weed. Now, butterfly weed is one of the monarch's very favorite pollinating plants. And it's a long-lived perennial that thrives in sun and just about any type of soil. It will Doesn't care if it's hot or humid or drought, even poor soil, it will thrive. It gets 2 to 2.5 feet tall, and you can take the seeds from that plant and reseed them yourself or just let them fly. The next one is Celosia dracula. Darkens to blood red in the sunlight. Well, actually, if you put it in the sunlight, it goes from blood red to almost a midnight violet. So if you want it to be darker, you put it in the sun. It's a dramatic plant, and it's a very short plant. Canna South Pacific Orange. This is a canna lily. It'll grow 4 to 5 feet tall like the rest of them, but it's bright orange, and it'll be different in your garden because it's such a pretty color. Poppies. I always like poppies. These are the oriental poppies. It's a mixture of poppies, but the neat thing about them is that they have crinkly, silk-like petals, and they have double blooms and are just really neat. They're best sown if you just throw them in the ground. They like sandy soil but lots of sun. Zinnia Cinderella Lilac. You know how much I love zinnias. And these are really unusual. They resemble the pincushion flower. They have double blooms. The blooms get 2 to 3 inches wide. And this was the interesting part. During warm days, when the days are warm and the nights are warm, you'll see a lot of single flowers. But when the day and night temperatures are different, that's when the double blooms will arrive. So it's something that you can keep looking at and figuring out that it's different. This squash is a really cool squash. It has a history to it too. It's called Gaite Okasunmin, or it's Ojibwe for really cool squash, which it is. About 10 years ago on an archaeological dig near Green Bay, they found a little clay vessel. They called it a clay ball, and when they shook it, there was something inside. Turned out to be these squash seeds. This is like a giant banana squash. It's been preserved. Those seeds were preserved for about 800 years. It has the flavor of an acorn squash, but it's much sweeter and very large. So that one's going to be interesting to grow.
I think they grow about 18 pounds.
Yes.
Was that the one that they thought was brought up from Guatemala?
I don't know about that. It's just that they found it buried under the ground in a clay pot. So we've always liked spaghetti squash. We've liked the Zeppelin squash. This is called Sugarette Hybrid Spaghetti Squash. And it, to me, it reminds me of a hybrid between the two. It's compact, and it is determinate. That means it doesn't go crazy all over your garden. It just stays short. All of the fruit will get ready about the same time, so you can take it out when it's done and plant something else that's a shorter lived thing like spinach or lettuce after you take it out. It's very sugary, but it's also rich and creamy. So Rick, you ought to love that one. We've often grown eggplant in our garden. And I really like these little ones, these small fingerlings they're called. And this is a blend of several different kinds together. They like sunny places to live, and they're compact. And if you get them when they're small, they're rich and flavorful and very colorful. Now, this is one we have never tried before. This is a fig tree. It's called Violet de Bordeaux fig. It grows in zones 5 through 8. It gets 6 to 10 feet tall, and it needs sun. It has beautiful spring flowers that are very fragrant, which will turn into actual figs that you can eat. It's self-fertile. It produces twice a year. It's disease and drought resistant, pest resistant, and the deer don't like it. Now, one we're worried about, but we're gonna try it, is a kiwi. It's called the Jenny variety. The zone is 6 to 10, so we're 5, you know, about 5 and a half. It actually grows tiny little fuzzy kiwis that are just like the kiwis you would buy in the store, but they're small. It's a vine, though, and it grows 20 to about 20 feet long and 13 feet wide. We're going to have to put it in a place where we can have it near the house so it absorbs the heat, and then we'll mulch it really well and see how it does. Sweetheart blueberries. Now, we've grown blueberries. We know what they're like and how much we love them. This is a sweetheart one that is supposedly gives you 2 crops of blueberries. And it says it'll give you 15 pounds of berries a year. We'll see what that one does. First crop is in early summer, and the last one is in late summer. So it'll be interesting to see. It's, I believe, a self-pollinator, so you don't have to have another kind. Borealis honeyberry. This is similar to a blueberry. It does have some tartness to it, but it's sugary sweet, and it prefers a bit of shade. So we'll see how different that is than the blueberries. Very hardy. We've often grown raspberries, but we wanted to try this one, Carolyn raspberry plant. It's a largest fruit that you can get. It has bushels of flavorful scarlet berries. It's an ever-bearing, self-pollinating one. Supposedly it starts in June and it will continue producing berries until winter. Gets 4 feet tall. It's disease resistant. We've tried growing beets before, and the deer have eaten them off, so we're going to be careful with these. This is a rainbow beet mix. There's 4 different kinds, well, actually 5 different kinds of beets, all different colors. Each one has its own flavor and sweetness to it. Those will be interesting. Smaller the better if you want tenderness. And then we are doing a lot of coleus this season, and we're going to start the seeds inside. I think the Marble Giant Exposition has a nice round growing habit. It's very vigorous and has uniform color and a neater growing habit. Kong Empire Mix. This one it's 18 to 20 inches. It's always in bloom, so you'll have leaf color actually all year round, all season long, not year round. Pachysandra Giant Exhibition Coleus Seeds. This is a black velvet coleus. It likes to grow in the shade. It'll get 10 to 16 inches high, and it's a soft velvety leaf to it. Now this one I'm looking forward to. This is the Black Dragon Coleus. It's all textured. It's richly textured, warm color foliage. It's compact, easy to grow. The leaves will turn color as they grow, and they will start puckering at an early age. So they start out flat, and then they get that puckery texture to them. Then we have the giant exhibition of all different varieties of the coleus. And they will grow from 12 to 15 inches tall. Coleus were originally meant to be grown in the house as houseplants. Who knew? Dahlias. We've had lots of lovely dahlias. This one is the Manhattan Island Dahlia. 10-inch flowers, fiery red and yellow petals, and double blooms, sturdy stems. Again, dahlias need lots of sun and lots of fertile, well-drained soil. Tropicana canna. Wow, the leaves on this alone, you don't even need any flowers, although it does have flowers. They start out purple, and when they unfurl, they quickly turn to that orange, gold, and crimson leaf. Just the leaves alone are beautiful. The flower itself is orange, and again, they need plenty of organic material and a nice, richly moist place to grow. One thing we're trying that's different this year is called the Blue Dawn Fusible. This is a seed that's been put together but they're two different kinds of plants. One is a petunia called Easy Wave, and the other one is a Bacopa blutopia. That's the little pink one in the middle, and then the petunia. And they grow together out of the same seed pod. Another dahlia we're growing is the Caballero dahlia, which is absolutely gorgeous. It's 4 to 6 inch wide blooms, sturdy stalks. It has an elegant water lily look to it. The insides of the petals are red and the outsides are yellow. Ought to be beautiful. Dark butterfly dahlia. This one has huge flowers. They're called the dinner plate size flowers. It grows 44 inches tall and has sturdy stalks, so you shouldn't have to stake it. Lizanetta dahlia is a cactus type dinner plate dahlia. It has yellow blooms with red streaks and tips. It's a 30 to 36 inch plant, so it's a little more compact than the others. It keeps blooming while some of the annuals and the perennials in your yard have petered out. It's not bothered. Dahlias are pretty much never bothered by deer or rabbit or other pests, but the bees and the butterflies love them. And last but not least, it's Maki dahlia. This one is a compact, more bushy. It'll be very impressive. The flowers are 8 to 10 inches across, and again, the butterflies and the bees love them. Well, we hope this gives you an idea of what we're going to be putting in our eclectic experimental garden. We always like to try new things and see how they do. And thank you for the tips people have been giving us about what they'd like to see. And thank you for people that have sent us seeds and given us ideas about what grows well in their garden. Thank you so much for watching. We can't wait to get things started, and we'll keep you informed and show you how things are coming along. Thanks again. Hope you liked this video. If you did, please give us a thumbs up. We'd appreciate that. And if you'd like to become part of our garden family, if you aren't already, please pop that little subscription button down there at the bottom and become part of our garden family.
Connect with us on YouTube.